Good morning, everybody. Welcome to today's webinar. Today, we're going to be looking at local adjustments in Capture One, a very powerful and useful feature, and also a lot of fun to experiment with. So that's our task for today. If this is your first webinar and you have no idea who you're listening to, my name's David. I'm part of the software sales team based out of Copenhagen in Denmark. Our session today is going to run for probably 60 minutes. I'm sure we can easily fill our allotted time there. You are very welcome to ask questions throughout the webinar and, of course, at the end as well. The way you do that, if you're on your Mac or PC, if you look at the bottom of your GoToWebinar control panel, you'll see a section called Questions. Put a question in there and that will come straight through to me. Similarly, if you're on your iOS device, or Android device, you'll see a question mark icon on the screen. Tap that, and again, the question will come straight through to me. The session is being recorded too, so you can watch that again at your leisure. It goes up on our YouTube channel on a playlist reserved specifically for webinars. And you can watch this webinar and all the previous webinars as well. That playlist comes to you in a follow-up email in a couple of days' time, so you need to look out for that. Okay, that's that taken care of. Let's move back over to Capture One. Just give me a second to turn on the main screen, which you should be seeing just about now. To help you locate the cursor, you might see it popping up in those crosshairs like so, just to help you locate it. So what we're gonna do is, if any of you were joining last week when we looked at some black and white work with a guest, that we used local adjustments quite extensively. So what we do today is that we will really break down the very basics of how to work with local adjustments in Capture One and a few different techniques of how you can apply it. So if you're looking for local adjustments in your default workspace, which is here, window, workspace, default, if you're looking for it, the local adjustments are in this tool tab here. That looks like a paintbrush. So if you click on that, then this will bring up the local adjustments panel. Now, first thing to mention is that not every single tool can work with a local adjustment. The idea of a local adjustment is that you can create a mask on the image, and you'll see different ways how to make a mask, and then you can apply those adjustments just in that area. And the way you do that is either by using a brush to draw a mask or using something called a gradient mask. So let's just have a look at how the brush works first of all. Let me just go to my, I'm just going to go to my default workspace just to make sure that I've got all the various tools loaded. And this will and this will look exactly how you look if you load up Capture One with the default space. So down here, if we look at the bottom of the panel here, these are various different controls that you have. The first one is this brush settings panel, but there's actually an easier way to get to that, which we'll look at in a minute. The second icon is how you wish to create the mask. That's either drawing a mask or raising a mask or making a gradient mask. And you'll also see some options about whether you want to see the mask or not. Note in brackets, you have some shortcut keys. So B for draw, E for erase, G for gradient. Excuse me. And how to display the mask as well. So M is something I use quite a lot to turn the mask on and off. So if you select the brush, what actually happens? Well, we have the crosshair or the brush pattern that you can see up here. Now, if we right click or control click, then you can see you've got various different sliders to change how the brush behaves, size, hardness, and opacity. So size, I guess, is pretty obvious, but let's just show you what hardness looks like. I'm just going to draw a brush along here. Let's just press M on the keyboard so you can see the mask. So that's with hardness set to 100. If we go back down to zero and I draw again, then you can see how that looks. So that's really the feathering of the mask. Now, if you look at the brush on screen now, you'll see an inner circle and an outer circle. The inner to outer circle, that's where it fades down to zero completely, or like zero mask. So that gives you an idea where the complete edge of the mask is and how it feathers like so. There's also the third control. Let's just change that a bit. Let's drop the opacity down a bit. Opacity, very important technique to know about when using local adjustments. If I brush now, you see that the red is fainter, the mask is fainter, so it has less effect. If I brush over the same area, then we actually build up the layers of the local adjustments. If you don't like red as your mask color, if we look in preferences, it's under appearance, I think. Local adjustment, you've got mask color here, so you can change the mask color to anything that you like if you wish, if you don't want it to be red. So now with the mask set, if I just press M on the keyboard to hide the mask, if I was just to pull something like exposure, you can see the exposure only adjusts in those particular areas. So that's the basic premise of mask drawing, like so. There's also something called an auto mask, which we'll look at a bit later, that automatically detects edges. And there's also use pen pressure. So if you have a Wacom tablet, which I'm using now, which is probably vital to get the best use out of local adjustments, then you can use the pen pressure to moderate the brush size. That's not something I really do. I don't really find a need for it, but you can try that if you wish. We come back to the sort of Wacom or tablet side of things later, but I will say it makes life a lot easier. It's much more comfortable using a pen and a tablet as opposed to using a mouse. You don't have to spend a bunch of money on very high-end stuff. Some of the really basic Wacom tablets, like the Bamboo, for example, is 100 times better than trying to do any of this stuff with a mouse. Also, if we look up here in the top right of our local adjustment palette, there's some other options which we're going to be having a look at today as well. Okay, let's get rid of our rather sort of useless layer. That doesn't really help us much. Let's come back to this image, and we'll just do something really basic so you can see how this works. So we've got a leaf, as you can see, on a background. Now, good thing about local adjustments is that we can often use them to sort of, in many ways, but in this case, to sort of isolate a foreground subject from a background subject. We can use creative control like dodging and burning, which techniques from the dark room, lightening and darkening and local areas, balancing the image, controlling exposure, all kinds of different ways you can use local adjustments. So if we wanted to do a really basic example, workflow goes like this. So we're going to choose our brush. You can either click it here or up here, or of course press B on your keyboard. Control or right click to get your brush settings right. So let's go relatively hard and full opacity. Now, remember it's M on the keyboard, so if I wanted to just isolate this leaf, and probably something that you'll see today, I don't worry too much about being super accurate round edges as such. The reason for that is generally, if you're reasonably all right, then it tends to be good enough. And often if you really accurately go around something, it looks really obvious that you've kind of done a mask, whereas if it's a bit rougher, then it's not so obvious. That's a little bit rough, so of course I can press E on my keyboard to get the eraser up, and then we can just sort of clean up these edges a bit. Now, I've got a hole in the middle. Now, I could sort of brush that in, but we can use one of the options in the context menu up here, which says Fill Mask. So if we say Fill Mask, pop, then it pops it into the center like so. M to hide the mask, and now you can see here under local adjustments that we're actually building up layers. So if you're used to working with Photoshop, it's a very similar way. You just build up layers of all your various different adjustments. You can name them, which is a very good idea. So if I just double click and call that leaf, especially if you end up with the maximum of 16 layers, if they're all called layer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, then it's pretty difficult to know what each one does. So what could I do here? Well, it's a nice color. But let's, before we go any further, do we need to do anything with exposure? Probably not. We could just tweak our levels and midtones. This is working on the whole image so far. And I want the leaf to really jump out from the background. So what we could do is just add some clarity on the leaf a little bit more. Whoops, I'm on the background. Let's get to my correct layer up here and then bump up the clarity just on the leaf. It's maybe getting a little bit burnt out, so we could usefully have some local highlight recovery. And if we zoom in a little bit, what we could find is that under the clarity tool, if we add a bit of structure, then this will bring out the sharpening on the leaf a bit more, make it super crisp, but that's not happening on the background because I don't have much sharpness on the background and I don't want to affect that. Maybe a touch more contrast as well. So that's just a really simple way we can use local adjustment. If you want to preview what it's doing, we can turn it off like so. So that turns it on, that turns it off. Turns on and off. So we've made a change just to that one area, and you can see even though I didn't have a super accurate mask, it doesn't really matter because we can't really see the effect of those changes in the background. Now if I wanted to go one stage further, like I could sort of drop, you can see how the sliders change as we go to the different layers, so that's showing me the adjustment on each layer. I could actually darken the, so if I just darken the overall exposure and go back to leaf and then brighten that up if I wanted to make that jump out from the background a little more. Remember, it's all non-destructive. It doesn't matter which order you do this in. So if I thought the background was a bit too aggressive, then we could go down like so. So it gives you that ability to really sort of work on different areas of the image at the same time, and then put some vignetting in as well. So very simple technique. If we just say image, let's just clone variant to get it how it looked at the without any adjustments. Oh, sorry, I should have said new variant, not clone, that's just made a copy. But I can reset everything like so. And let's have a look at the one I adjusted. Command B to hide the browser, should you want to know that. Command T to hide the tools. So you can see quite a big difference just with a really basic use of a local adjustment. So all of you, I'm sure, are more than capable to do that and start working on that with your images. Let's have a look at what should we do next. Let's do another sort of basic brushwork, and then we get a little bit more advanced. So, and we can use a couple of the tools here like inverting and copying masks. So that's our original unedited image. I'll just check. Let's just reset just to make sure. And that's one I did some time ago just with a couple of adjustments. So again, before going to local adjustments, let's just see if we can do anything on the image in a broad scale. Exposure looks all right. I mean, he's a little bit bright maybe, so I maybe just cut down the exposure a touch. We could fix our levels, maybe darken the midtones a bit. So that's already looking much better. But what if we wanted to just drop the background out a little bit more, but keep him pretty much as is? And I think the ISO here, what is it? ISO 1000, so it's relatively high. So there's a little tiny bit of noise going on in the background. So what I think I'll do is, sharpening wise, let's just cut the sharpening out over the whole image. Because there's no point sharpening the background. There's nothing there to sharpen. So let's just think about sharpening the subject itself. So first of all, let's make a mask for our dragon friend. So we say plus here. Let's call this dragon. It is a bearded dragon, I think. Lizard experts, let me know if that's wrong. Right click. Let's just get the size and hardness right. Let's go relatively small. M on the keyboard if you want to see the mask, and then we can just work around here like so. Probably don't have to worry about the spikes too much. You could spend a little bit more care if you wanted to, but you see it's with a pen, it's pretty simple to draw relatively accurately. There's no way I could do this with, whoops, Command Z to edit. Redo. I did an undo. I just want to press E for eraser and just take that. Check out photos for OS X. No, thank you. Let's get rid of that. B for brush once more. So we can do the same thing as before. Rather than having to color in the mask, we can just simply say fill mask, and that fills the mask in like so. If we wanted to worry about the spiky bits, they're kind of dropping out of focus anyway, so there's not much to fix on those. M to hide the mask again, and now we can work on our dragon guy here. So what should we do with him? Well, we could probably improve it. Let's just zoom in a touch. Improve him with a bit of clarity, I would think. Let's just see clarity overall, just a bit more of that. Let's tiny bit more contrast. We might be able to bring some highlights back. High dynamic range, let's bring highlight recovery back a tiny bit. And saturation wise, I don't know if it's a bit too saturated. No, it's probably all right. Double click a slider to reset to zero, by the way. So I think that's probably all right. What we will do in terms of sharpening again, remember we took all the sharpening off. So let's just bring in more sharpening onto this guy just to snap him up a bit. And as we've got all this fine detail in the eye and the scales and that sort of stuff, again, structure helps to improve that. So now we've sharpened him up nicely, but we're not sharpening the background. So if we wanted to, we could stop there, because that's just really a simple sharpening exercise that sharpens our foreground, but doesn't really sharpen the background, because there's nothing there to sharpen, and it's noisy. But what if we wanted to sort of play around with the density of the background without affecting our dragon? So what we can do is we can make another layer. Let's just call this isolated background. Remember, the default background layer here is simply the whole image. So if I was to select background and then adjust exposure, for example, that would affect the entire image. So let's go to isolated background. This doesn't have any mask on it whatsoever. It's just a new layer. Peter says, are you sure you didn't sharpen the whole image? Let's check. Well, maybe I did. On background, we've got sharpening set to, correct. So I need to be on dragon. And let's do our sharpening there. I was on the wrong layer. Thanks for pointing that out. Yeah, so background, we've got no clarity or structure. On dragon, we've got our sharpening and our clarity and structure. On background, we've got no sharpening. So thank you. I'm glad someone's watching. That was just a test to make sure you were paying attention, of course. So what did I do? We made a new layer, isolated background. And rather than drawing around the background, there's no point, because what we can do is we can say copy mask from dragon. That's going to give me the same mask. If I press M, you can see we've got our mask here. And now if I say invert mask, that's simply going to flip it like so. So now we've got the background. So now I've got control over the background. So if I did want to, say, drop that exposure down a bit, I could. If I wanted to sort of desaturate it, I could. If it was, I felt it was due to distracting, but I actually quite like it as it is. But just a simple drop in exposure could be interesting as well. So rather than have to redraw a mask for the background, if you've already got an existing mask that works, if you flip it, then so much the better. And then maybe we're just throwing a little bit of vignetting, which is over the whole image. So very sort of simple tweaks like that. If we say new variant once again, then you can see before and after. Command B to hide the browser, Command T to hide the tools, and you can see like so. So again, a couple of simple tweaks, and you can go a long way. Good question from Terry. Is there a way to adjust the radius and threshold of the sharpening on adjustment layer? Kind of yes and no. If we just go back to this guy, if you look on the background layer, you see we've got 0.81 on dragon. They're grayed out because we have to use the same radius and threshold on each layer. So the idea would be on the background layer would be to adjust it here. So we could drop that right down. If we look at dragon now, you see that the threshold is copied across. So you can't mix radius and thresholds on different layers, just the amount. So probably a case of mathematics. It's just not possible. But we can freely sort of We can freely sharpen this layer if we just go crazy with the sharpening for a moment. So loads of sharpening, but you see it's not happening on the background. So that's really handy. Think about that for portraits. Like if you just wanted to sharpen up the eyes on this guy and the mouth, for example, on a portrait, then that could be a really good way to do that without over sharpening skin tones and all that sort of stuff. So he looks nice and crispy now without having to sharpen up that background. Okay, let's step it up a bit and then show you an example about gradients. So we have an image here, my poor attempt at a Gursky, and we can see that we've got three areas that sort of are behaving in a different way. We've got the sky, we've got the sea, or maybe the sky and the sea are pretty similar, and we've got the pebbles in the front. Yes, in the UK we have beaches with pebbles, not always sand. So we can use our gradient mask to try and level all this up a little bit. If we just play with the exposure a second, quite often a good thing to do, you can really see how much dynamic range there is in an image. You see we've got tons of detail in the sky. So there's plenty of detail that we can liberate there. There's plenty in the pebbles at the front. So really, just by this simple exercise, we know all the data's there. We just have to balance it up and access it. So I know with the sky that and the sea, I can handle that with a local adjustment. The pebbles wise, let's sort of think about that as our base exposure. So it's probably good somewhere around there. If we turn on our exposure warning, you can see that we're starting to lose or blowing out in the sky, for example. But let's worry about that in a minute. So if I think about pebbles, first of all, what can we do with that? Well, exposure is okay. We could probably sharpen them up a little bit, for example, or add a bit of clarity and structure just to make them jump out a little bit more. So this is where we can use our gradient tool. So if we go over here and then click and hold, then we can choose gradient mask, and then you get a slightly different cursor, which just looks like a cross. If we drag, and you can see where I start to drag, the gradient is strongest, and where I finish dragging, the gradient fades to zero. So if we just turn our mask on, and I can draw a few different gradients to see. So if we started at the top, went all the way down, we get a very subtle blend all the way from top to bottom. Much like having a gradient filter in front of the lens. If you want a harder fall off, then we could just draw a much shorter gradient like so, and you can see it's much more solid there. If we really wanted a sharp fall off, if I just drew a short line like that, you can see then we get a really hard gradient like so. Now, if you're trying to keep this nice and straight and level whilst you're drawing, if you hold the shift key down, then it will keep it vertical, horizontal, or 45 degrees. So that's with the shift key. So if I let go now, then you can see the kind of gradient mask we get there. Good question from Jeff. Can you return and adjust the angle of a gradient, or do you have to redraw it? You have to redraw it. So once your gradient is in, then we can't adjust the angle. We can edit the gradient, which we're going to do a bit later, because the gradient is just a simple way of drawing a mask, but we can still add to this gradient or take it away, which is really handy in some landscape stuff, because we don't always have perfect horizons. We might have mountains, for example. We might have other objects that we don't want the gradient to affect. You don't get that benefit, of course, if you're doing this with a filter on the lens, but we do when we can work in our digital darkroom as such. So pebble wise, actually I just discovered something new. If you just click once, then you get your hard edge gradient like that. So that's interesting. Right, so pebble wise, what can we do here? Well, I just want really to isolate this area. So if I just do a short line like that, sorry, starting from the bottom and working my way up, then that's probably pretty good for my pebbles. A little bit of bleed on the sea doesn't matter. So now let's label that. Let's call that pebbles, like so. And let's just throw in a bit more clarity so they jump out a bit more, and a little bit of structure as well. Contrast wise, we can maybe just a bit of contrast and just brighten them up a tiny bit. So if we turn this layer on and off, then they look a bit murky to looking a bit more dynamic. So next area could be sky and sea together. Now what I could do, as we've got this gradient mask, let's just say plus new layer and say sky and sea. Let's handle it in one, see if that works. Again, what I could do is just simply right click and say copy mask from pebbles and then invert mask. That's just another way of doing it. You could just draw another gradient if you wanted to, but if we look at our mask now, you see we've got the exact inverse of that. So what could we do with the sky? Well, it's a bit bright, so let's turn on our exposure warning a second, and let's just knock that exposure down to something that I think's good. And if I think that, is that edge maybe a bit too hard? I think it is, you know. So I'm going to revert what I did. I'm just going to take my gradient mask again. And then I want it to bleed off a little bit into the sea, so it's at least natural. So let's try something like that. Oops, I adjusted my pebbles. Got to make a new layer first. Bad teacher. Let's call that sky and sea again. And the good thing is about this, you can experiment, of course. You know, you've got a raw file, non-destructive. We can just play around time and time again. So that's my mask now. I think that's maybe a bit better. Maybe I'll just draw that like that. Yeah, so I think I'll stick with that because I don't want to darken the sea off too much because there's obviously light hitting it there, so it's going to look a bit too fake if I go crazy. And we'll do a third step where we could adjust that. So turn on my exposure warning. Let's just drop this down to something that I think is going to be good. We could bring a bit of highlight recovery back as well if we wanted, which is a really nice thing to have on a local layer. So I'm happy with that. So now we've done a bit more to our sky, but we can still make it more dramatic. So we can add some clarity again. There's no point adding structure to this because we don't have really fine detail to sharpen or anything like that. So there's no point adding structure. I can still probably drop exposure a bit, maybe have a bit more contrast. And then that's pretty good. There's a dust spot there. That's going to really bother me. So let's just get rid of that very, very quickly. Spot removal, we've got two choices, dust and spot. This is dust on my sensor, so I choose dust, take the icon here, and then click once, and then that takes that away. Now, the good thing is, because that's a spot removal on the raw file in Capture One, as I come to adjust the various layers, then that spot removal automatically adjusts with it as well. So really, there's not super much more to do. What I could do if I wanted, if I just sit back a little bit and look at what's happening, then, you know, I'm generally pretty happy with that. What we can do and what I do a lot with local adjustments is, if you like, the darkroom equivalent to dodging and burning. I tend to call it light and then darken because dodging and burning with a negative on a print, what does that really mean when it comes to a digital image? So I find it just easier to say lighten and darken. So I might want to selectively darken some of the hottest areas of the clouds that I think are a bit too bright, like up here, it's a bit distracting. Maybe it's a little bit too bright along the center of the image here. So how do we do some selective lightening and darkening? So let's say plus rather, and I call this darken. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is actually invert the layer. And you'll see why in a minute. So I'm going to say invert mask. If I press M on the keyboard, you'll see I've got a mask over the whole image, like so. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to drop my exposure down until I think I'm looking at this area here. I don't care about the rest of the image. I'm just looking up in the top left. Where do I think that will be a good point to have that? So probably somewhere around there, perhaps. And I'll push it a little bit more. And then here and here and sort of in here, that's probably, I want to be somewhere around there. So I can see the effect of what that layer is going to do, but I only want to apply it selectively. So let's say invert mask back again. And now I can brush in the areas of the mask that I want to have the effect on that layer. So I'm going to take my brush and we right click and we probably want it nice and soft. Now, if I leave the opacity at 100, you're going to see what's going to happen. Oh, that looks really sort of super obvious and nasty, doesn't it? So let's undo that and let's change my opacity to something really low, probably surprisingly low, you might think. So I've dropped that down to around 8, because what that means is, and especially if you have a tablet, we can just click brush, click brush, click brush. And it's nice and subtle. You don't get any hard edges. So I'm just brushing in the areas that are a little bit too bright that I think are distracting. And this could be on the whole image. It doesn't have to be just the sky. So every time I click brush, I'm building up density. So if I just overdo it a little bit in the middle, you can see how much darker that got. If I wanted to emphasize the clouds, we could just do a little bit in there. Let's make that a bit smaller. We could do a little bit along this line here as such and in there. If we wanted to take away the hot spot in the sea here at the center, we could go nice and large, and then I could just do a couple of swipes across it there. A little bit more there as such. So that's just a nice way to darken that off. Norman saying, what Wacom am I using? This is a Intuos 5 Touch. They don't make it anymore. I think it's called an Intuos Pro. It's only a small one. It's tiny. It's like the size of a, I guess the area is the size of an A5 piece of paper, but that's plenty big enough. If it was any bigger, it wouldn't fit on my desk comfortably, I don't think. But it doesn't have to be one of those. A bamboo works just as well. The more expensive ones have more levels of pressure sensitivity, but as I don't use the pressure sensitivity, I don't really care about that too much. So this is a really nice way to play with an image. If you're as old as me and you worked in the darkroom, then it's kind of what we did, making different shapes with our hands and cutting holes in cardboard and dodging and burning and all that sort of stuff. But this is a far less messy way to do it. So if we turn this layer on and off, darken, then you can see what it did. So it just took the heat out of the top area of that sky a bit. And we can always return to that layer and do a bit more, like if I want to make that cloud darker all along this line, etc. Very simple. And the pebbles, did I want to darken anything off here? Probably not. I like the fact that they're a little bit brighter. To do the similar thing, which we're not going to do on the image, we're going to do on a different one, we could lighten, we would just change our exposure. Now, the good thing is about having the low opacity, as I said, it's very unnoticeable what we've done, and we can still moderate it with our exposure slider. So if I thought, well, I could darken that a bit more, we could push that down. It's looking a bit obvious now, so let's bring it back up. So I think I would leave it there for that image, I would think. Would I vignette slightly? Maybe. If we go back to our local adjustments, let's turn them all off. So that's where we started pretty much. Then we did a bit of structure, contrast, clarity to the pebbles. We did our sky and sea grad filter. Let's press M so you can see it, like so. And then we just had our selective darkening layer, like so. Let's say image, new variant. You can see the before and after, Command B, Command T, quite different somewhat. So we're lucky with relatively new digital cameras that they have loads of information in the file. It's just how you choose to extract it and capture one, which is the key. Before we get to the next image, let's just answer a simple question from Jean-Claude, which is a good question actually. It says, adjusting saturation, is there anything like the vibrancy of Lightroom? And even though that's not really relating to local adjustments, then it does have some impact on how you use the saturation slider here. So if I just go to a different image for a second, hopefully I can find it. this one. So saturation that you see here in the exposure tool is a vibrancy slider. We just don't name it vibrancy. So you see, if you look at this red arrow, if we bump up the saturation, it is getting more saturated, but it is somewhat controlled. So colors that are already heavily saturated don't get the same treatment as those colors which are less saturated. If we go negatively, then the impact is the same across the whole image. Positively, there's some intelligence to it. So if I do the same with the color editor, which we're going to use for the local adjustment later, if I pick the same red and bump up the saturation, whoa, you can see what happens. It oversaturates because that's a pure control down to you. So saturation in the color editor is simply plus minus, more, or less. In the saturation slider here, it's based on some intelligence and what's in the actual image. So good question there, Jean-Claude. How am I moving around when zoomed in? That's a good basic question from Alta. Well, I do a number of things. You see the cursor keys up here. This changes the behavior of what the cursor is doing. So if I press H, I have the hand tool selected. I can double click to zoom in, double click to zoom out. If you prefer, you can use big head to go to 100%, little head to go to fit screen, etc., or you can drag the slider like so, or you can use your Photoshop shortcuts, option command plus, command plus, command zero to fit in, and so on. If you watch the previous webinar, I think Introduction to Capture One, then there's a little bit in there about navigating around Capture One. Mike says, if you overdo one particular step by gradually recovering shadows, is it possible to undo a specific step or a particular step? So we don't have a history, but you can do multiple undos. So you can just say edit, undo, 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 and you can step back. So yes, it is possible. Or you could use your erase brush and just erase what you did. Okay, let's step it up a bit. And we'll look a little bit at auto mask and also editing a gradient. So you can see that was a somewhat finished image messing around with, and that's what we started with. So there is stuff in the sky, we just have to extract it. And we can do that with a gradient mask, of course, but we might want to edit our gradient mask. And we can also do that with the auto mask at the same time. So first of all, let's just fix our crop. Let's, rather than recropping, I'm just going to borrow the crop from this one, as that's a pretty good crop. And first of all, exposure wise, for the whole image, let's just drop the exposure down a bit. I'm just looking at the foreground here. I know the sky is kind of a lost cause. If we wanted to try and adjust the whole image, we're down here somewhere, shooting into the sun on a cloudy day. So let's just think about the foreground for 1 second. So that's pretty okay. Happy with that. On the whole image, what about if we adjust our levels? We could maybe improve it somewhat. Contrast rise, let's see if we can do anything. Clarity. We've got some grass and the stones in the front. This was an older camera, so it's not the sharpest image in the world. So we can't really push structure too much because the lens just didn't really cut it for that particular camera. So that's a good base start for that image before we start to do anything else. Local adjustment wise, we know there's stuff going on in the sky. We just have to access it. So again, we could do that with a gradient mask, but it's going to throw up another problem. So I'll probably start drawing around here and then finish around here. Press M on the keyboard. It's probably about right. Maybe I could risk going a bit lower. Let's see. If I just play with the exposure a minute, it's probably doing the right thing that we need to in the sky. You can always drop it down like really low, and then you can just redraw a few times to see, because I don't want it bleeding in here too much, but equally we want it to make sure it's doing what it needs to do on the sky. So that's pretty good. I'm happy with that. I am going to turn this into a black and white in a minute. I tend to try and get somewhere relatively good with a color image before going to black and white. So that's probably the best we're going to get the sky right now, exposure wise. So let's go to black and white. All we need to do is turn on black and white like so. I think it's a nicer image in black and white for some reason, this one. Can we make any adjustments? Let's see what we can do with the reds. Not much going on with red, probably some with yellow. So we could darken or brighten the grass a bit. So let's up that. And then there's really not much. We've got some blue in the sky, so we could drop the blue down a bit to make those areas darker. And then magenta-wise, not much. So there's only really a couple of the sliders that are having much of an effect. So let's stick with that. Now we need to fix our gradient because, of course, what the gradient's done, while it's darkened the sky, it's also darkening the stones, which kind of is not what we want. And that's the kind of issue we would get if we were using, you know, the filter on the camera, that we can't control where that filter moderates, but we can with a local adjustment. So let's just call this grad sky so we know where we're at. Let's add another layer. No, actually, we're not going to add a layer. Let's just edit the gradient. We could make a lighten layer. And we could try and, as we did before, lighten the stones. But as we've got a good separation between sky and stones, we can just scrub away some of the gradient mask. So the way we can do this is erase mask, like so. Now, again, if we had 100% and then we tried to carefully draw our way around the mask, it's going to look pretty obvious. Again, we're trying to go for natural look. That's why often... why I don't tend to use a lot of auto masking, because I think it's too obvious as such. So what we're going to do here, though, is use an auto mask, but still we're going to drop our opacity down to something around there, and we're going to turn auto mask on. Now I've got three circles. So the center circle is my sample circle, my sampling zone, if you like. So if I start erasing here, like so, it's only going to erase the lower tone on the stone itself. So I'm going to get a pretty good erase without affecting the sky. Now, if I want it to be stronger, I can up the opacity a little bit. And you might find that, or you will find that, you're only going to see it's affecting the sky. But when I let go, that's when the auto mask snaps in. So now I can do a nice job of erasing the gradient, but without actually affecting the sky. But I still want to do this on a low opacity, because if this was suddenly as bright as it was before, it's going to look really sort of obvious. That's the danger of auto masking sometimes, that it just looks fake. So by keeping the opacity low, it also gives us the ability to moderate, like so. So I can just do a bit more general brushing here. And this is a sort of a darker area, so we could attack that a little bit more, and so on. And then finally over here. So auto mask can be really handy. Oh, look, there's a bird sitting on top there. I didn't notice that before. And brush like so. So you can see again, if I brush down there, do you see it's affected the sky? But when I let go of the pen, then it does the auto mask calculation. So it's really handy for this kind of subject. It's still a bit too dark up there. So let's just pull a bit of that back again. See, by having a low opacity, it gives me the ability to repeatedly brighten. If this was on 100%, it would start to look really quite odd. So... now, I'd probably do a little bit more, but you don't really want to watch me painting for another 5 minutes. So let's just call it that we've done that, so you get the idea of the take. How do you select the erase brush? Jean-Claude said it's here. So you either say draw or erase, or use B or E. To make it auto to detect edges, then you need to right-click and check the auto mask box, but I'm pretty happy with that. So now if we look at the mask, depends if we can see It's a fainter red where I was sort of doing the negative auto masking than it was on the sky. And the result is now when we turn the grad sky on and off, it's still darkening my stones a bit, but it's not as obvious. And we could still just carry on and remove some of that. So auto mask is really brilliantly handy for that. So I've darkened my sky nicely, but I'm not affecting the stones too much. Now the sky is still a bit boring, I think. So if we add clarity to the gradient, might have to push a lot, and then we could have a bit more contrast. There we go. I don't know if I can get any more highlights back. Oh yeah, I can a bit actually. I can. Don't want it to look too fake though. Say this image wasn't shot with the same camera as the last image, so I'm not blessed with the dynamic range I had here compared to this one, but we can still do something. I think that's this area here is probably, no, it's not blown out, but it just, I have to be careful that we probably can't really get any more the density in that, but that's pretty good. I think we'll leave it at that in that respect. Let's just crop out that guy. And then overall, if we go back to our background layer, we could probably have a bit more clarity, I reckon. And if I wanted to, again, we could add an additional layer, and I'll just call this, just going to call this lighten. And we can do a similar thing. We could invert the mask so it affects the whole image. And then let's just, I'm just thinking I might brighten the foreground a bit, not by much, just a little bit. And let's say invert back. And now if I take my draw mask brush or B on the keyboard, right click to check your settings. Let's go a bit smaller, low opacity again, nice and soft. If I just, probably a bit too low opacity. If I just want to lighten up this section a little tiny bit. And then if I wanted to lighten up any other areas in general, we could just have a little bit more light there and so on. And then to finish, darken the corners a bit. And maybe as we're black and white and it's not the sharpest image in the world, just to hide that unfortunate error, we could have a little bit of grain as well. Why not? Grain tool works really nicely. It's a mathematical model of a grain structure. So if we have, you pick the grain type that you'd like to have, the impact is kind of the opacity of how obvious the grain is. From 0 to obviously 100%, and then the granularity is how grainy it is as such. I think that's probably a little bit over sharp, this image, so let's just scale that back a bit. And there we go. So if we say once more image, a new variant, it's quite a long way different to what it was before. Just with a few tweaks of some local adjustments. That image, that's like almost an instant delete when you cast over it. This image, you know, I really don't mind that at all, to be honest. Before the next image, let's just answer some of your questions. Is there a shortcut to enable disable the different layers? No, there isn't, unfortunately, but it's not a good idea. Let's see, Jean-Claude saying, is it my understanding that you can't adjust the exposure of the erase brush? That's why you use opacity. Well, yeah, I mean, the brush is either adding a mask or taking away a mask. How much of that mask is sort of edited or removed is really down to opacity. So probably what you're more used to in Photoshop, for example, you can take a layer and you could adjust the opacity here, for example, but you can't do that as such. Remember, we're working on raw data, so there's a ton of mathematical calculations going on. If we have too much going on, then it compromises performance, and it probably wouldn't be as nice to use as it is now. Correct, PT, you can only edit a gradient mask with brush, and you can't add a gradient to an existing gradient as such. So if I tried to do double gradients, then the next gradient always overrides the second one. Does change in the opacity only apply to subsequent brush strokes? Yes, it does. So change in the opacity is brush behavior as such, not the opacity of the entire layer. So it's opacity of the brush. But that's why I say if you keep it low, then you've got loads of sort of, if I just go back to lighten again, if we just wanted to lighten this area, we can just do a couple of clicks. Let's get rid of the other image. If we just wanted to lighten this area, then we can just tap, tap, nice low opacity. So we've always got the ability to correct the error of our ways if we need to. Okay, so I'd say that image is done as much. It's only two local adjustments. So gradient in the sky, which we edited, and then we've just got a little light and layer, which did some stuff with this kind of grassy bank in the foreground, and also, as I just demonstrated, on the stones there. Okay. Alrighty. Next image. So we've looked at some basic stuff. So let's kind of, well, we've looked at basic and some more advanced stuff. So how much time we got? That's the important thing. Oh, not much. So one thing, the final thing really we need to look at is some basic retouching. Maybe retouching is the wrong word, just sort of a basic repair of an image. So Capture One, it's not a retouching tool. But we can do some sort of basic repair of images based on the layer sort of principle as well. So you might have seen when we say plus here, you can actually also make a clone and a heal layer. So cloning is simply a copy of one part of the image to elsewhere. It's very similar or exact as the tool in Photoshop. And a heal layer does a similar thing, but the luminosity gets matched at the destination so that it's a more intelligent repair. So let's make a new heal layer, like so, and we just call this Almond Delete. And let's say we just wanted to get rid of this collection here. We thought that was too clumsy in our shot. So you'll notice that now the icon looks slightly different. I've got those four arrows around the edge of the tool. So the first thing I need to do is select my source point. So what do I want to copy over this area here? So like Photoshop, if I hold my Alt key down and click once, then that sets my source point. Now I just need to say, well, what do I want to get rid of? So if I start brushing like so, wait for it to calculate and it disappears. If we turn the mask on, then I could brush here and we could brush over here like so. And then that will simply take this area and then heal to that point, like so. If we want to, at some point, we can change this to clone if we wish, but that's just a direct sort of copy of that information to this information. Here we try to match the luminosity better so it's less obvious. So that's just a simple way to get rid of that. Now, per layer, there's only one source point. So if we wanted to, say, get rid of something, I don't know, down here, like let's say we wanted to get rid of this one or this dirt, whatever, I would make another layer and then same process, take my draw mask brush, whoops, right click, let's turn that into a heal layer, like so, and then select my source point by alt clicking, and then we could then take this away as such. And then calculate, boom. So for basic retouching like that, it works really, really nicely. For extensive retouching, then you've got to go to Photoshop or your preferred next step in your process. So it's good for sort of basic removal, cleanup, like so. Auto mask, a couple of you are asking, like, how else would I use that? So I just show you a simple example here. So let's say we wanted to darken off the sky and we've got a sort of a complex structure like this. If we just drop that down, you can see there's plenty of data in the sky. I want my castle exposure to be something like that. So again, what would I do? I would right click. Oh, sorry, let's add a layer, call this sky. Right click, let's just drop the size and hardness up a bit, and opacity full, and auto mask on. So now we are sampling the sky. So if we turn our mask on so you can see, so you'll see I'm brushing, it's going into the castle wall, but when I let go, see it auto masks around it, like so. So if you wanted to auto mask around this, you could. We might have to just go a bit bigger there. So we can just go into that. And then we could also auto mask around this edge if we wanted to. So that's how the auto mask works. So the center circle is your sample point. When the outer edge hits something that doesn't match the sample point, then it's not masked. So if I brush like so, then we're just going to mask around that and here, for example. La la la. So that'd be, whoops. Wacom's got a mind of its own there. So that would be a way to mask around that edge. If we turn the mask off, then you can see it's just masking along the edge. However, the way I would approach this image, because I think if you do auto mask around the edge, it looks too obvious. I think it confuses our brain or whatever. So what I would probably do is I would make a, I'll do it quickly as we're low on time. I'd make a gradient mask kind of like this, and then darken that corner down. I'd probably then make another gradient mask like this, and then darken that corner down. And then I would either do what we did before. If I wanted to, I could take my erase brush, and on a low opacity, and once more, I could then take a little bit out the castle walls, probably up the opacity a bit, like so. Because I think that would be generally faster than trying to do it the other way and look a bit more natural as well. So I think I could do that much quicker than sort of going. Also, the shape of it fits better as well. And then on this layer, we could do a similar thing like so. Obviously, if I had more time, I'd do a better job of it. But I think that's probably what I would do in that case. Or instead of doing the sort of erasing, I could just make a new layer, call that lighten, have some positive exposure. Don't want my auto mask, and we want B for brush. Low opacity once more, and then I could just lighten up a few areas as well if I wanted to. I think that would look much more natural than having a really hard edge of an auto mask around it. So even though that was a quick and dirty sort of adjustment, I think that works pretty well. Okay, we're nearly out of time, so let's just go to the last questions. Peter's saying, is a plus correction on one layer completely undone with a minus correction on another layer? Yes. So if we had plus one on layer one and then minus one on layer two, then it would be totally reverse. But you're not damaging the image at all, because remember, it's all non-destructive. So you can do that. If you've darkened up one layer too much, almost like we did here, like we had our darkening grad, and then I choose to lighten layer to, say, lighten up various different areas, then that's fine. You're not, like, ruining pixels, because it's just simply an additive or subtractive process through all those different layers. Ernst is saying, I can't use the heel layers with the Fuji sensors. Is that correct? Yes, you can't use the auto mask either with the Fuji X-Trans sensor, because a lot of the mathematics is based on a standard RGB sensor matrix, which the Fuji sensor doesn't have. So unfortunately, if you're a Fuji owner, you get obviously some benefits from the REV sensor, but there's also some negatives as well. Can I edit individual spots afterwards? Yes, you can. The spot removal is not on a layer, so it's on the background, if you like. So if I had a big spot here, which I removed, even if I suddenly decided to adjust the exposure of my sky grad, then that spot automatically compensates as well. Shortcuts for adjusting brush size. Yes, you can use square bracket, like Photoshop, square bracket left, square bracket right, shift square bracket for the hardness, as you can see, as I'm adjusting now. There is one for opacity, but I can't remember what it is. You can also, if you're using your Wacom, what you can do, I used to do it, but in actual fact, I just found it faster to right click. Under, where is it, functions. This, if you've got on the Wacom the touch ring, you can actually use the touch ring. If you swipe clockwise or anti-clockwise, you can use the touch ring to make the brush bigger and smaller. You would just have to program in the keystroke of square bracket. But yeah, square bracket or simply right click and adjust that way. I find that pretty fast. Any situation where clone is better than heal? Joachim is asking. I guess if you wanted to copy an element from one part of the image to another, but generally heal tends to work best. Final question. Is it possible to save an edited image along with all the edit steps so I can go back and change it all required? You don't get a history of edit steps, but remember this is all non-destructive. So if I came back to this tomorrow and thought, well, that's really, that grad sky is way too dark, then of course there's nothing to stop me editing it, but you don't get a full list of history. The reason for that really is, as I said, because everything is non-destructive, so you're free to edit as many times as you like. Can you draw a vector mask? Last question from Garrett. No, you can't draw a vector mask, unfortunately. Okay, so unfortunately, I think that brings us to the end. There was one thing that I didn't get to show you, and I'm going to show it really quickly now. It's more about color editing than local adjustments, but if it's interesting, just hang around for 2 minutes. Simple issue that often comes up. Let's say we want to edit the color in an image somewhere. So if we took our color editor and we chose gold, and then I say, let's say I want to brighten that up, then you see it's affecting the background as well. So a very powerful thing you can do in a local adjustment is a local color edit. So if I just make a new layer and call that gold, draw a very quick and dirty mask, full opacity. So it's just going to be messy like this. Doesn't have to be fancy and accurate. Within that mask, use the color editor to select the color tone, and now I'm free to lighten and saturate without affecting the background. So just think about that. If you want to edit color, but it's affecting other areas in the image, use a local adjustment to do that. Similarly, if we have something like this, let's get rid of that layer, and I want to make the blue sky a bit more something. If I pick the blue sky and then darken it and increase saturation, then you see it's also affecting like the door and the flowers in the front. Again, go to a local adjustment, make a new one. Again, quick and dirty, we could just nice and big brush. Only really worry about the blue areas. And then within that mask, pick with the color editor, and now I can bump up saturation, drop density without affecting the rest of the image. So just a little bonus tip there. Local adjustment with color editor, very, very powerful. Don't forget about that. Other adjustments that we didn't get to was local noise reduction. Again, if you've got noisy shadows, you could use a mask to get rid of noise. Local sharpening we looked at, a little bit of local high dynamic range, local moiré reduction if you're a fashion photographer or fabrics, just use that to get rid of moiré and fabric. Color editor we just looked at. Purple fringing, that's just one of the lens corrections. You can locally reduce purple fringing if you wish. So that really is the end of the tips. Just while I have you here, if you want to come next week too. Next week is about using styles and presets. So we're lucky in Capture One that we have all these tools, but sometimes it's nice to return to a particular preset that you like to have. So we can save presets for tools or styles which encompass a number of other tools. So I'll show you how to make and create those styles and various other things to do with that as well. Look out for the follow-up email in a couple of days' time. I have a link to register for that webinar and also the YouTube playlist where you can watch the recording and previous ones as well. So many thanks for your time. I hope you found it useful, and I really hope to see you back throughout September. Take care.